Hello everyone. Today I'm going to be talking about reclusive YouTube shouty man Paul Joseph Watson, and in particular his video The Truth About Popular Culture, in which he argues that today's popular culture is ugly and decadent and meaningless, whereas in the past it was apparently beautiful and uplifting and meaningful. Now, where Paul has went wrong here is that, being someone who is currently alive, he is primarily exposed to contemporary culture and art which has not yet had the opportunity to pass the test of time. But when he looks to the past, he only sees great works of art, and this isn't because the past is filled with exclusively great works of art, it's simply because all the rubbish art wasn't preserved in the same way that the great art was. Because it was rubbish. You know, time acts as a filter, sorting the valuable from the worthless, and in the future, the same will be true of our generation's art and culture. Anyway, thanks a lot for watching, everyone. Remember to like and subscribe, and you can follow me on Twitter. Yeah, okay. The old fake end to the video. It's a classic. So okay, even though I do feel like that was the fatal flaw in his argument, there is a bit more to say here, so let's flesh things out a bit. And I should add a disclaimer here that I've already watched a couple of responses to Paul's video, made by people who know a lot more about popular culture than me, so you should probably just go and watch those videos instead of my comparatively poor offering. I personally don't know all that much about modern art or music, you see, but I do know how to kick a man when he's down, so here we go. Now, Paul tends to wander a bit in his arguments, which is fine. You know, so do I, but he also frequently cuts himself off to insert a clip of him shouting something that's usually only possibly related to what he was already saying. As a result of this, his video's a bit of a mess, narratively speaking, so rather than go through the video chronologically, I'm just going to break his argument down into sections. So, part one. Popular culture, and when Paul says popular culture here, he cites modern television, art, music, theatre, celebrity culture, whatever. That all used to be wholesome and uplifting, apparently, but is now a load of meaningless rubbish.
Culture is supposed to be uplifting. It's supposed to infuse our lives with intrigue, lust for knowledge, and appreciation of beauty. Instead, for the past two decades, pop culture has only served as a sewer pipe of projectile diarrhea aimed directly at our gawping mouths.
So there's nothing that weird so far. This is your standard grumpy old man argument, just being held by someone 30 years too young. This attitude is hardly exclusive to our generation, you know. Are there any Fallout fans in the audience?
In olden days, a glimpse of stocking was a look thought of something shocking, but now God knows anything goes.
And this is from 1934. However, part two is where this gets a bit more interesting. This degradation of art and culture was orchestrated deliberately by cultural Marxists in order to undermine and eventually destroy Western civilization. And that's a bit more like it, because, let's be honest, that sort of conspiracy nonsense is what we're really here for, isn't it? Look at Karl Marx there, being evil. Anyway, let's get to addressing these points, and I would first advise people to go and watch Paul's video so you can be sure I'm not misrepresenting his views. I will be using some clips from his video as we go on, but I'll also be proceeding under the assumption that everyone watching from now on has seen it. Hey, I had to watch it, you know, the least you can do is watch it as well. You can take breaks if you like I did. So okay, first off, art and culture used to be good, and now it's all a load of rubbish. Is that true? Well, to answer that, we first need to determine what sort of timescale we're talking about. At what point was the art supposed to have gone from good to bad? Paul is rather vague with his timescales here and gives a few rather different answers about when exactly he thinks this cultural degradation started. You'd think, from the thumbnail of the video being Miley Cyrus and him talking about reality television and the likes, that he's talking about the last decade or so. But he is pinning all this on the so-called cultural Marxists, and he shows this very scary picture of the Frankfurt School. But that has roots back in the 20s and 30s, and Paul even features Duchamp's Fountain in the section of his video complaining about modern art. an art piece which is now literally a century old. And you think he would have noticed that because it has the date printed on it right there if you look. So, what's my point here? Well, Paul's timeline is all messed up. He's showing things that he varyingly calls good or bad and acting like there's some sort of chronology to it, when there isn't really. You know, he uses clips from modern TV shows and movies and music that he seems to think are pretty good, that came out half a century or more after this supposed cultural Marxist takeover of society started filling the art museums with urinals and the likes. So let's talk about this urinal, actually. Now, again, I don't know too much about art history, but I know that this particular piece is kind of a big deal. And I agree with that. I think it's great. Although I wouldn't fault someone who, like Paul, was thinking, well, how can this be great? It's just an everyday thing like a urinal. It's meaningless. Well, the work of art here is not so much the urinal, it's in the act of exhibiting the urinal. It makes an important point about art, and in the case of this piece, it's a point that hadn't really been made before. It provokes debate about what art is and where the boundaries are. That's the point of a lot of modern art, actually. You know, they're not aiming for Michelangelo's David and ending up with a urinal accidentally. There's a point behind it. Speaking of behinds, how's that for a link there?
A giant ass was nominated for the Turner Prize. I mean, forget full retard. We've gone full idiocracy.
Now then, Paul, what you missed was the Turner Prize website just openly states the Turner Prize provokes debate about art. Like, that is one of its actual aims. And I don't know if Paul noticed this, but it worked, didn't it? It got him talking about what is and is not art, at least. And it provoked me to ask a question, you know, can a representation of an arse be art? So let's have a think. This is The Tennis Girl, a popular British poster from 1976 showing a photograph of a lady playing tennis and revealing her posterior. What do we think? Is this art or not? I bring this up because in 2015 the Wimbledon Twitter account tweeted a picture of the poster, and then got into some mildly hot water about tweeting out a photograph of a bare arse, and they deleted it and apologised. Now, given that it was something that happened and it was on the internet, of course, feminists got the blame for it. Those evil social justice warriors going around censoring art.
Radical feminists are once again channeling their inner ISIS by attempting to eradicate iconic art from the pages of history. The Athena Tennis Girl poster is one of the most archetypal images of the last 50 years. It sold more than 20 million copies worldwide. But when the Wimbledon Tennis Club announced that they would feature the photograph at an exhibition called Powerful Posters, third wave feminists went to war, tweeting their invective until the Wimbledon Club caved in and apologised. By the end of the night, some feminists were calling for the poster to be, quote, eradicated from history, justifying the cultural cleansing of art to appease their warped political dogma, in the same spirit as ISIS militants when they destroy ancient artifacts in the Middle East, in the same spirit as Hitler and Stalin, who banned beautiful and iconic art because it didn't conform with their extremist authoritarian tastes.
Art it is then, according to Paul. So that's interesting, isn't it? This is not art, but this is art. I'm going to have to invent something here called the Paul Joseph Watson arse art scale. So at one end we have art. This is art, clearly a classic photograph of an arse that must be protected from the attentions of the evil feminists. This, on the other hand, this is not art. This is a pointless and meaningless waste of time and effort. So the point here, Paul, is betwixt these dual cheeks of art and not art, there is an invisible crack, shall we say. A dividing line that separates the art from the not art. You know, at what point does something become art? What criteria did you use to classify this as art and this as not being art? I mean, I disagree with you personally. I think they're both art, but I'm judging them by different criteria than you are, clearly. And the point of a lot of conceptual art is to provoke exactly these sorts of boundary discussions. When you tell a story about some conceptual art piece getting mistaken for something else, you know, you accidentally sat on a chair because you didn't realise it was meant to be art, a cleaner threw out an exhibit because they didn't realise it was art, that's the point, man, you know? And yes, a lot of it might be rubbish, but that's the risk they're taking, you know? And I'd like to point something out here. Paul's acting like all contemporary art is fringe conceptual art.
Have you ever visited Tate Modern in London? It's a giant building full of scrap metal, concrete blocks, urinals, and this. Whatever it is, they call it an art gallery. It more closely resembles a landfill site.
However, this is just not the case. Let's take a look at what's on in the Tate Modern right now, using internet. An exhibition of a fine art portrait photographer. An exhibition of Sir Elton John's photographic collection. An exhibition of 6 decades of the works of early pop artist Robert Rauschenberg. A bunch of these cool sorts of fish things. And there's also a bunch of films being shown and art workshops and tours and talks and things. It's not all dog turds in bags, you know, Paul. You're just cherry-picking the most intentionally provocative fringe stuff and making it seem like that's all there is. Actually, this is Paul's tactic for all the subjects he covers in his video, not just the modern art section, you know. Deliberately choosing only the most provocative things to react to, like the time Salon.com featured a video by an open paedophile.
They're fetishizing pathology. We're even seeing the mainstreaming of paedophilia by the news and entertainment media. Salon.com giving a platform to a wannabe child molester.
Now, I went and watched that video, and that guy was making the case that he's not a child molester and doesn't want to abuse children, but he acknowledges his attraction to children, and that it's a problem, and he wants to help other people like him get help. Which, you know, am I crazy? Because that seems like it's a good thing, but, you know, whatever. And a fun point of comparison here is Milo Yiannopoulos recently landing himself in trouble by, funnily enough, appearing to condone child molestation, and who leapt to his defence but, of course, Paul Joseph Watson, who oddly doesn't seem to be all that bothered by child abuse when the person supporting it happens to share his political opinions. Paul also sees fit to judge all modern television by a few cherry-picked provocative moments.
Look at television. TV's endless portrayal of broken families, emasculated male figures, and aberrant, nihilistic, droog-like youths.
Broken families and emasculated male figures, you say. Now, this confused me because elsewhere in the video, Paul condemns modern theatre for not being as good as Shakespeare.
Look at modern theatre. We went from Shakespeare and Oscar Wilde to this. They're making everything that's supposed to be exquisite, hideous and repugnant.
Now the inference there is that Paul thinks Shakespeare is good, I guess, but he doesn't like depictions of broken families and emasculated male figures, so he likes King Lear, but not depictions of broken families, and he likes Macbeth, but not emasculated male figures. Is that all correct, Paul? Because I'm very sorry, but I have to conclude that you don't actually know what you're talking about when it comes to Shakespeare. You just know he's got a reputation for being good, but you don't really seem to understand why that is. Now, I like these sorts of little contradictory points. Shall we do another one?
What has my generation contributed to advanced popular culture over the last 30 years? Humiliatingly little. Seriously, what have we contributed? Can you name anything positive?
So what can we name from popular culture from the last 30 years that is actually good? Well, when Paul is elsewhere complaining about the state of modern music, he shows as positive examples Nirvana and Marilyn Manson, who, Paul, both came to prominence in the last 30 years. There's also the point here that Paul is again neglecting to mention the test of time. You know, there's all sorts of music around today, but who knows what people decades in the future are going to still be listening to. And when he mentions those bands, Paul is lamenting the fact that there isn't a counterculture movement anymore. You know, it used to be that you'd have the mainstream, and then the various alternative scenes, but today, apparently, we've only got the one thing. You're only ever allowed to listen to One Direction and Miley Cyrus, apparently, and nothing else. This is very silly, of course, because Paul is avoiding talking about something key here, and it's odd because it's the thing he personally uses to get his own videos out there. It's the internet. You see, way back in the pre-internet olden times, whatever television you could watch was limited to whatever happened to be on the two or three channels you could get, and the only movies you could watch were whatever was in the cinema, and likewise, the only music you were listening to was what was on the radio. There really was a dominant media mainstream back then to organise against. Today, though, those sorts of movements aren't as necessary. If you don't like One Direction or Justin Bieber or whatever, you can just ignore them, because thanks to the internet, you've got instant access to all different types of things, and an opportunity to meet other people who are also into those sorts of things. Now, just speaking personally, but I read Japanese authors and watch Korean TV shows and American films and listen to music and play video games from all over the place. I personally couldn't give a toss what's in the current top 10 because I don't have to be exposed to it if I don't want to be. Speaking of video games actually, why doesn't Paul talk about games in his video? Video games are an increasingly large part of modern popular culture and they've gotten more violent and sexual over the years. Actually, I can just put Paul's narration over some video game footage to make this point.
Popular culture is also hypersexualized. It's not prudish to observe that the sexual imagery we're bombarded with is infinitely more gratuitous than it was just 25 years ago.
But since Paul's audience is made up of a bunch of video game playing teenage boys, he'd never do that, would he, you know? He's got them all sitting there nodding along with him condemning the violence and sex on television, but not in video games. Still gotta pander to the Gamergate crowd, I see, Paul. So, increased violence and sex on television is indoctrinating the youth into thinking that that behaviour is normal. But increased violence and sex in video games, well, that could never have any negative effects, could it? It's funny to see Paul using Anita Sarkeesian's arguments just aimed at every other aspect of popular culture except for video games. Just before I wrap up here, I'd like to talk about something else that Paul is neglecting to mention, something that actually is behind a lot of the problems he is mistakenly attributing to this imagined cultural decline, and that's economics. For instance, here's Paul talking about modern suicide rates.
It's no surprise that since the explosion of celebrity-led narcissism, young people are more depressed than ever. Suicides amongst those aged 10 to 24 are up every year since 2010. Why are you all so unhappy? Because you're aspiring to something completely vacuous and unobtainable for the vast majority of people.
Suicide rates have been going up lately, apparently, and this is down to cultural degradation, according to Paul. But does anyone remember anything else from the late noughties that could possibly be a contributing factor here? Something rather big sprung to mind for me. You see, we're living in the aftermath of the worst financial crisis since the Great Depression. I think that that might be having more of an effect on the state of people's mental health than Jersey Shore or whatever Katy Perry is up to. Paul does something similar with the US incarceration rate.
Gangster rap, a movement that encouraged millions upon millions of young people to aspire to act like degenerate criminal thugs. Yeah, that worked out great, didn't it?
You see, he's blaming the effects of the government's failed war on drugs policies on gangster rap, which is putting the cart before the horse, to put it mildly. You see, because Paul's so focused on trying to expose the imaginary cultural Marxist puppet masters behind all the problems with popular culture, he fails to notice that a lot of these problems are actually capitalist in nature. You know, why are the celebrities doing these provocative things? Well, because it's provocative, it gets attention, it gets an audience, and they need as big an audience as possible to make as much money as they possibly can. It's the same reason that you, Paul, used a provocative photograph of Miley Cyrus as the thumbnail for your video. You didn't have to do that. I mean, you also mentioned Shakespeare in the video, but you didn't use this as the thumbnail, did you? Because you knew that this would get more clicks. Paul's guilty of a lot of what he criticizes here. He looks down on a woman filming her own face and talking before cutting back to a film of his own talking face, with apparently no irony whatsoever. He condemns people for being social media obsessed while bragging on his Twitter account about how many followers he has. He plays this clip to represent rubbish popular music.
Why do you think everything sounds the same? The same procession of electronic beats, repeated hooks, and verbal diarrhea that passes for popular music now.
But he then closes his video out with this. I mean, why not some nice violins instead, Paul? You know, some Beethoven, maybe. So, what's my conclusion here? Well, Paul, do you want to come for a drink, man? You know, get out the house a bit. I think you've got cabin fever, dude. It's not healthy. And this is a genuine offer, by the way. I will actually get the train down and take you for a drink if you're up for it. Thanks a lot for watching, everyone. Remember to like and subscribe if you feel like, and follow me on Twitter, even though I mainly just talk a load of nonsense. And if you'd like more videos like this, consider pledging me a dollar over on Patreon. We're more than halfway to our next milestone over there, and would you believe it, I'm very excited about the whole thing. The generosity of my supporters has blown me away, and now I am dead. Anyway, see you next time.